Excellent. Remember last time we effectively started talking about conservation principles, conservation of mass, conservation of energy. We even talked about conservation of angular momentum to talk about some of the fundamental principles that explain variations in lapse rate. We talked about the lapse rate tendency equation. We used conservation of mass to come up with a couple of relationships that effectively showed us that the divergence in the atmosphere can be linked to pressure tendency. So in the case where we have deep divergence occurring within the atmosphere, over here, negative del dot u integrated through the vertical. This alone refers to convergence. So we have net divergence of the column. The integrand here will be negative, and the net result will be pressure falls at the surface. So we talk about divergence. We're talking about effectively atmospheric forcing, and that's going to be the theme overall of today's class. Forcing within the atmosphere and how that manifests itself in a response that potentially affects sensible weather. In this particular case, we're talking about responses such as height tendencies or height change, as well as vertical motion at a large scale within the atmosphere. So let's talk about a couple of these equations over here right now. Suppose that we have in the atmosphere a forcing of deep divergence. What's the response going to be? How is the atmosphere responding? Effectively, when we're talking about deep divergence, we're talking about a deviation from geostrophic balance. Remember, the geostrophic wind is non-divergent. So we have a forcing of deep divergence take place with a response down low if surface pressure falls. At the same time, there's going to be some response owing to the deviation from geostrophic balance. The atmosphere wants to be in balance. It wants to have geostrophic balance, hydrostatic balance. And so there's going to be a response, in this case we're talking about vertical motion, that is going to correspond to the deviation from geostrophic balance. Effectively, the atmosphere is going to adjust in order to try to assume geostrophy once again. And we're going to use the conservation of mass principles to effectively illustrate that. Remember, we showed from last class we can express the rate of change of density with respect to time following the motion of a parcel of air as a function of the divergence fields over here. And we're going to work with that equation right now. Let's assume that we're dealing with an incompressible atmosphere, one such that the density following the motion of a parcel of air is not changing, is invariant. Therefore, in this case, d rho dt is going to go to 0, and this is going to 0 in the incompressible atmosphere. So that's an assumption we're going to make, effectively a crude assumption of what an atmosphere could look like. And we're going to see the net divergence del dot u is going to go to 0 in this particular case. Now let's work with that equation over here for the incompressible atmosphere. And we're going to integrate both sides of that basic equation del dot u as follows. We'll integrate from the bottom of a column of air to the top of a column of air of the right-hand side. We're going to bring that to the left-hand side, so 0 dz. And that's going to be equal to the integral from zb to zt of del dot u dz. So we're just integrating both sides of this equation from conservation of mass with respect to z. And let's expand the right-hand side integrand to account for both, and again, integrating from the bottom to the top, we're going to expand the integrand to account for horizontal velocity as well as vertical velocity. We can expand that to be the following. Del h dot uh plus partial w partial z. So we're just expanding out our dot product over here, maintaining the dot product over here, and then separating out the rate of change of vertical motion with respect to height, dz. And we can then split up this integral into two separate integrals over here. So carrying this down here, this is going to be equal to the integral from the bottom to the top of del h dot uh dz plus the integral from the bottom to the top of partial w partial z dz. And then now in this particular case over here, this is going to be equal to, let's actually leave this integral as it is, the integral from the bottom to the top of del h dot uh dz. And then let's actually, since we're dealing with a definite integral over here, we know the dz's effectively cancel out in some respect over here, divide out, leaving us with the integral from bottom to top of partial w or dw. And that's going to result in the following difference over here. Wt minus Wb, so vertical velocity at the top of the column minus the vertical velocity at the bottom of the full column of the atmosphere, and we know that is going to be equal to 0 from conservation of mass. impermeability within the atmosphere, at the bounds of the atmosphere, so the bottom, the ground is impermeable, so there's no vertical motion, and we're going to assume no exchanges of mass, or effectively no vertical motion at the top of the atmosphere, such that the vertical velocity at the top of the atmosphere also goes to zero, leaving us with the following relationship over here, the integral from the bottom of the column of air to the top of del h dot uh dz, so the horizontal velocity divergence is equal to zero in our incompressible atmosphere over here. So we talked about, again, if we have net divergence forcing in the atmosphere that's serving as a forcing, we're going to have pressure falls. That's something we talked about last time, east of the trough. Mid-level shortwave trough, we're going to have net deep divergence, and we're going to have net pressure falls over here. At the same time, we've seen that the vertical integral over here of the horizontal velocity divergence is going to be zero in the incompressible atmosphere. Therefore, if we're going to have net deep divergence applied as forcing, it's going to have to be compensated by convergence in some part of the atmosphere. So if we have deep divergence aloft, downstream of the shortwave trough, in the case of the incompressible atmosphere, it's going to have to be balanced by, in this case, low-level convergence in order for the vertical integral of the horizontal velocity of divergence to go to zero. In other words, mass is conserved. That's the notion here in the incompressible atmosphere. So if we have, let's look at just conceptually here, going up with height. If we have a shortwave trough coming and we have net divergence throughout our column of air over here, net divergence, it will have to be compensated in the incompressible atmosphere by convergence down below. Now, what's going to be the implication with respect to vertical motion? That's what we're going to talk about right now. Let's go back to the relationship that del dot u is equal to zero. And again, we're going to consider this in terms of a horizontal component, del h dot uh, separating that out from the gradient of the velocity associated with vertical motion, partial w, partial z, not the gradient of the velocity, but rather the gradient dotted with the velocity, a correction there. And in this case, it's going to be zero for the incompressible atmosphere, such that partial w, partial z, is equal to minus del h dot uh over here, just bringing that to the right-hand side. And then considering this as a finite difference, w at the top of the column of air minus w at the bottom of the column of air divided by delta z is equal to, over here, minus del h dot uh. But now when we're considering this to be, over here, a truncation of that column of air such that the top is actually somewhere, say, midway through the column of air, and the bottom is the ground, which is impermeable, such that there's no vertical motion at the ground, this goes to zero. Well, we've already established that for mass conservation, the net divergence has to be balanced by convergence down low. So if we have convergence down low, the del dot u is going to be less than zero. Negative times a negative is going to be positive, which implies that at the top of our truncated column of air that extends to the mid-levels, wt is going to have to be greater than zero, and we get rising motion. That's really interesting. That's exactly what we see happening from a conceptual perspective. We have net divergence that induces, as a response, convergence down low and upward motion. We've used no QG theory here. We've effectively considered a crude approximation for the atmosphere and compressibility combined with conservation of mass. Looked at what happens when we take the atmosphere away from geostrophic balance. It tries to readjust to geostrophy by inducing convergence down low, and in this case, upward or rising motion over here, and pressure falls at the same time, a manifestation of conservation of mass. And all those things are happening all at the same time. Now, let's consider the case. We'll just talk about this briefly. Say we have a shortwave trough and associated divergence forcing, that's what I'll refer to it as downstream of the shortwave trough, lifting northeastward across parts of New England. The attendant frontal boundary can sometimes arc into the southeastern United States and become effectively decoupled from the deeper divergence forcing, if you want to say. Now the cold front, it's still going to be a zone of low-level ascent, still going to be a zone of low-level convergence, while the deeper divergence associated with the deeper mass response is going to be headed potentially away from the southern extent of that cold front boundary. Sometimes in Florida, what we'll see is that the shortwave trough is lifting off to the northeast across parts of New England, whereas the front still coming southward across parts of the southeastern United States. And in those circumstances, that's not particularly effective at supporting maintenance of convective precipitation along that frontal boundary as the deeper ascent is lifting off to the northeast. Now, that makes sense from everything we've talked about here. Effectively, that frontal trough, a zone of relative low pressure, has become removed from the support for pressure falls associated with the deeper divergence forcing related to processes occurring downstream of the shortwave trough. And so the frontal trough associated with that cold front weakens. It becomes displaced from the deeper ascent downstream of the shortwave trough. Low-level ascent becomes increasingly shallow. We know that frontal band, that zone of low-level convergence, is becoming removed from processes downstream of the shortwave trough, like stretching, that influence steeper that support steeper mid-level lapse rates from last time discussion of the lapse rate tendency equation. And all of these factors come together. Also, remember some of the processes like the differential thermal advection that steepen lapse rates associated with the shortwave trough, those become removed from the low-level zone of ascent associated with the cold front, and we end up with a scenario where we have shallow ascent with less favorable thermodynamic conditions aloft, and convection is much more in a less favorable environment for occurring as we have the removal of the deeper divergence fields associated with the shortwave trough lift away from the frontal boundary. The frontal boundary is still going to be effectively spreading southeastward like a density current across parts of the southeast in some circumstances, maybe not a pure density current, but the idea of a spread, outward spread of relatively denser, colder, potentially drier air, while the deeper upper support, you've heard that phrase before, that's talking about all of this, becomes removed from the low-level ascent. We're in more distant from a source of pressure falls. Frontal trough weakens, front weakens, ascent becomes more shallow. Mid-level conditions are less favorable thermodynamically for deep convection, and we end up sometimes with just a shallow roll cloud along an extensive boundary that enters the Gulf of Mexico. And that's because things are our upper-level support is becoming out of phase with a low-level ascent. Now, so we have a conceptual understanding for how divergence has a relationship to pressure tendency down low, a conceptual relationship to vertical motion within the atmosphere, or low-level response, but a lot of times, and you've heard about this from other classes before, divergence has a lot of error. It supports a lot of error in our calculations. And we're going to want to come up with some conceptual model that is going to be less sensitive to some of the major errors that are inherent to divergence calculations. And that's why we talk about quasi-geostrophic theory, or in short, we're talking about an assumption that we're using the geostrophic wind in every term of every equation except for the divergence term in the quasi-geostrophic vorticity equation. And we're going to talk about how these deviations from balances such as geostrophic balance, which we're talking about related to divergence over here, and even hydrostatic balance manifest themselves in vertical motion. And so because of all the errors inherent to divergence, we're going to appeal to quasi-geostrophic theory to talk more about vertical motion as well as high tendencies. All right, that's the end of unit. And before I erase the board, questions per the request from last time?